everybody. So in today's tutorial, I'm going to go ahead and explain how to add colors or wefting into wigs. So as you can see on this one, there's these nice little gold yellow streaks that are actually been added into this wig. And even some on the inside as well. And I'm gonna go ahead and kind of explain how to do this and also make it so that it's not really bulky where you've added those wefts in there, the different colors on there. So it'll actually look like it's natural, like the wig was built with this setup. So I'm gonna go ahead and kind of explain how to do this. So the first things that you're actually going to be needing is the base wig and the wefting. And what I actually have is I'm going to be making an identical wig. This one was actually a commission for me. So I have a solid red wig, and then I actually have an identical wig just in blonde. These are actually the same pieces that I used in the other one, so I know that everything matches. And I'm gonna go ahead and show you how to remove the wefting from this one and get it attached onto this one. So on top of the wigs and the wefting, you're also going to need to have threads of the same color or close to the color of your wig. So since I'm using a red one, I have some red thread and some yellow one as well for the yellow wefting. Along with this, you're also going to need to have a hand needle. I'm a terrible person. I always love just hanging them into my hoodies and everything else like that. So a regular hand sewing needle, a couple of spare needles that you can kind of see the little dots right here, along with some wig heads. I'm actually going to be using two of them, so that I have one with the blonde wig and then one with the red wig as well, along with a pair of just regular simple scissors, and then also some reference stuff. Since I have the base wig already here, I'm just gonna be using that one as reference, but it's always good to have a reference image when you're doing this, that you know how thick, how long, and how wide you wanna have those additional colors added in. So let's go ahead and get started.
All right, so the first thing that you want to go ahead and do is put on the wig that you're going to be putting the wefting onto one of the wig heads, and go ahead and just pin it in place. It'll make it easier when you're removing the wefts. Also, on the bottom, it's always a good idea to pin it as well down there. Sometimes I don't do that normally, so now it's really important too. And then go ahead and just remove some of the tangles that'll probably be in there. Especially if this is an older wig or anything else like that, or it's just been sitting in the bag, there will be a fair bit of tangles. Then from here, we could go ahead and start removing the wefting. Now, if you have never actually looked at a wig before, the wefting is just kind of a stream of the synthetic fibers that are put together with some stitches. You can actually physically look at them. And then they're just sewn right onto the pieces of the wig, so the elastic and the spacing and everything else like that. And from there, you could go ahead and just start cutting off that sewing line. It's not really that hard. You can actually see it in most cases. They do sometimes try and blend the colors, but sometimes they'll also have it matching. So for this one, it was a little bit of this tan colored thread, so it was a little bit visible to see on this yellow wefting that was there. But from here, you go ahead and just start cutting off the wefting. And as you can see, I got the first one done, and I remove it from the rest of the hair. And to make this a little bit easier just on yourself, go ahead and just remove any tangles that have happened from the time that you were flipping the wig around. This is actually the only wefting that I do that on. The rest of them, I just kind of leave it. But that's mostly because I was recording and I didn't want to spend too much time doing a lot of this. And once you have one wefting removed, you could go ahead and just start removing the next couple of them as well. I'm sorry, I had a message from a friend, so I was kind of replying back to them, so you'll see me do that a few times. Now, one of the other things that I do like pointing out is if you have never actually had an opportunity to see how a wig is built, this is actually something that's really fun to do because you can see how your hair fits in it because of those elastic strips that are in there. You could see the spacing that's necessary when you're looking at the wefting as well. So you could kind of understand how your hair fits in it and why it's also important that if you were to, you know, separate one wig and put it into another one, why it's important to have a little bit of gapping in between everything so that it's not incredibly tight. And I'll go ahead and do a tutorial about how to add two wigs together. Right now, I just want to show you how to do color additions, basically. But Just go ahead and remove as many wefts as necessary or as many as you think you need. If you always have too many, you could just throw them in the bag with the rest of the wig as well. It's kind of one of those nice things about it. But it's just literally, you know, cut, run, cut, run, cut, run, cut, run. It just takes a little bit of time and a lot of practice to actually be able to do that. And if you do cut the elastic pieces, the little stretchy parts that the wefting is connected to, don't actually worry about that too much. It's just you do not want to cut any of the excess threads the wefting at all, just because we want to make sure that this wigs and all of the fibers are actually, you know, clean, easy to work with, and more manageable. And I do apologize about the lighting shifting and everything else like that. My movements have been causing the camera to kind of shift the lighting as well. I normally have a different light that I use, but it actually blew up that morning when I was recording this. It completely just, the cord popped off, but it was really old, so I do apologize. There might be a couple more tutorials that have weird lighting transitions and everything else like that. It's just because I'm still looking for a better light than what I had originally. So it's just going to be maybe a week or two or three of that. So I do apologize. A few more pieces. Also, if you get stuck at any point in time, or if you're worried about cutting the wefting instead of just the threads, you do have all freedom to actually use a seam ripper instead. I've had a lot of friends that actually prefer seam rippers just because you're able to find the threads that were holding the wefting onto the wig a lot easier, and you don't have to worry about cutting off the wig fibers. So if you prefer to have a seam ripper, go ahead and use that instead of the scissors. I've personally removed so much wefting that I could kind of see where every stitch is, and it takes practice. I know I say that a lot, but practice really does change how much progress you make with everything, so it's always good to kind of remember that. And even I get stuck on certain spots as well, so it's okay. Also, if you don't want to actually go through this entire progress, what you can do instead is go ahead and just buy loose wefting. They are available like that. For me, it's just easier to have a matching wig because then I know that the lengths are going to be the same, and also the curls will be the same as well. So once you have all of the wefting that you think that you'll be needing, and the nice thing is you can always go ahead and, you know, remove more as necessary, go ahead and grab the wig that you're going to be attaching it on. And we're going to go ahead and do the wig care prep. So this one was fresh out of the bag, so you remove everything from there, pin everything down the sides, the front, and the back. And then go ahead and just give it a quick comb through. And this will just get rid of all of that loose wefting that might have been there or anything else like that. Out of habit, I also just do the bangs just because I'm so used to doing that. Now, what we're going to go ahead and do is see if there is a skin cap on the wig. And what a skin cap actually is a piece of material that is supposed to mimic our own skin. Usually it's at the very top of the wig, and it has fibers in there that are really, really hard to cut. Now, you can kind of see where the skin cap is on the wig. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be leaving the skin cap part alone, and we're going to start removing the wefting below it. Now, with your reference image, go ahead and find where you need to put those colors, marks in there, the different colors in there, and go ahead and just mark it with two pins. Then the first step is to go ahead and remove the wig, or remove the hair out of the way that is connected to the skin cap. And again, the reason why I don't actually do the skin cap is because it is really hard to add wefting fibers in there. I've done it before. It's a pain. I'd rather just leave it as it is. And from here, we're just going to go ahead and remove the wefts. And all I did was I did one small snip at the base of the weft, and then I just ran across and snip the other one. Now, I only did right where the weft ends are. So you'll notice kind of where the fibers are all connected together. That's all I snip. I don't make any larger ones. I just go from there. And then I snip off the stitches that hold the fiber in place. And then I just snip off the other end. Now, you can actually remove as much as you want or as little as you want, depending on how big the streaks that you're after. I've actually had one wig that I completely removed all of the wig fibers through an entire section. But for this one, I'm just going to go ahead and remove four of them, and then we go from there. So the next step, and I was kind of showing it right there, you'll notice that the wig fibers are now loose because we cut some of those stitches. So we're actually going to go ahead and stitch those back down in place. So grab the matching thread and go ahead and thread the needle. Now, I am comfortable with hand sewing, so I actually go from about my fingertip to my elbow. So you can kind of see right there for the length of it and tie a knot on the bottom. I'm going to go ahead and zoom in. So you can kind of see the stitching better. And I just work from the bottom up. There really is no specific way of doing this. However, you want to make sure that your stitches are about 2 to 3 weft lines in from the top. And what I mean by that is if you try and stitch right where you've cut, the wig fibers are going to start getting loose. So you want to make sure that they're a little bit stable. And you'll notice that when you start doing this. But go ahead and just run up the line to go ahead and lock everything in place, and then tie a knot, and then do the exact same thing on the other side. This just makes it so that the wig itself is stable and you don't have to worry about your fibers getting loose or anything else like that. Now, if you do decide that you want to glue everything down, you do have all freedom to have that capability. I personally like hand sewing a little bit more just because then I know that everything's a little more stable and I'm always worried that glue is going to pop loose. Now, as you can see, the other side is now locked down, so we're going to go ahead and do it on this side as well. There's no real rhyme or reason or how many stitches you need to do. For me, it's usually only about 1 or 2 stitches and then I know that I'm locked down in place. And then instead of just, you know, sewing, tying a knot, cutting it off, putting another knot in, going to the next weft line, I've just learned if you go down the ladder, you'll know that they're locked in place and you'll know that they're held down as well. And now that our wefting is now locked down in place, we could go ahead and start adding the new color into this wig. And the easiest way to do this is to grab a piece of the wig fiber or the loose wefting and measure the spot. So it's about there to there. I usually make it a little bit longer. Oh, remember how I was talking that there was thread holding it in place? You can visibly see it and you can always just pop it out if you want to. But you always want to make sure that your wigs are, or your fiber lines are just a little bit longer than the actual hole. You do want to have a little bit of overlap. It's better to have a little bit of overlap than having it visible. You'll kind of understand if you make a mistake and you have this gap line that's visible. It'll be a little bit noticeable as you move around. So go ahead and just thread the needle and stitch it in place. There is no specific type of stitch that you can use or need to use. So I actually transition back and forth. So I will whip stitch occasionally, or I will just kind of go across the line. There's no specific rhyme or reason, but make sure that those ends are locked down in place. So a couple of stabilizing stitches, 1 or 2 of them, and then go ahead and just run down the line. These don't have to be overly big stitches. They don't have to be incredibly small stitches either. You just want to make sure that the wefting is connected to the lace. And it takes practice, it takes time. And a fun little trick, if you'll notice, when I'm doing the sewing, I'm always making sure that I'm either holding on to the thread itself or I'm putting it in a location that it doesn't get wrapped up with any of the wig fibers, because wig fibers are loose, and if you have your thread in the way, it's going to start getting it knotted up and everything else. Now, another fact for you as well, if you are working with a dark wig and you're adding a light color, you're going to want to put more wefting than what you removed. So if you'll notice, I removed 4 of them, By the end of this wig, I put about six in the location, so I kind of get them a little bit closer together. And that's kind of your decision on if you want to do it, but I have learned that if you are using lighter wefting on a darker wig, it is incredibly important that you do make sure that you have more fibers there, or it's not going to be as visible. Sorry, I had gotten another message from another friend during this time, so I was getting the answer to their question taken care of. There we go. Now, if you'll notice, I did not knot that one again. I'm just climbing up the ladder. It's because I had extra thread available, and there's frankly no reason to be wasteful about that type of thing. Just go ahead and climb up the ladder, go to the next one, and just keep going like that. There's no reason to knot at the end of every single one of them, so long as you know that your stitches are strong and sturdy, you're good to go. And again, I'm just using some quick whip stitches. That tends to be the easiest and quickest for me. And they're not, again, they're not very close, but they're not very loose either. I'm kind of trying to follow the same stitch line that the machines had when they had created this wig. And sometimes I have that capability, sometimes I don't. And again, if you want to use glue, you have all freedom to do that. You can use a tacky glue or a permanent glue. If you have a low temperature hot glue gun, you can try that if you want to, but be warned that this is synthetic fibers. There's always that chance of the fibers melting. So use hot glue at your own risk, but if you would prefer to use a permanent adhering glue, feel free to do that. And just run up the line. And again, practice, lots of practice, lots more practice, and even more practice will make this a lot smoother, a lot easier. I cannot tell you the amount of wigs that I have taken apart and put back together, which is why I'm able to move as quickly as I can and why I'm not stabbing the needle into the styrofoam head either. I'm just running it through the lace at this point in time. And again, practice, lots and lots of practice. Also, sorry, I forgot about this tip. If you would prefer, you do have the capability of getting a curved needle. And sometimes that makes weft adding a little bit easier just because if you'll notice, I'm using my nail a lot to kind of lift the needle. If you have a curved needle, it'll automatically, curve upward for you. And you can use that instead if you want to. I've gotten out of the habit of just using straight pins in my nails. My nail polish always hates me afterwards, but you do what you can. And we're almost done with this streak. And I'm only going to go ahead and show you guys how to add one streak right now. If you do want to see the rest of the wig now that it has been completed, I'll go ahead and put a link in the description just that you could go ahead and see how it looks compared to the original wig that I had created. Just more whip stitching, lots and lots of whip stitching. Again, doesn't have to be pretty. And you'll also notice my index finger right now is lifting up that skin cap that I was talking about and explaining. That's because I do not want to get the needle stuck through that. That is another type of heavier plastic, borderline. It's not latex, but it almost has the feel of latex. And if I puncture it, it's going to rip the skin cap. And I do not want to have those ginormous holes tucked in the skin cap. Even if it's not visible, I know it's there and it frustrates me. But I tend to be a little bit more of a perfectionist like that. If you puncture the skin cap, don't worry about it too much. And go ahead and just tie it off. And then to test how it actually looks, go ahead and comb it out so that everything kind of falls in place. And then realign the wig cap or the skin cap fibers as well, and figure out where you want them to fall. And what I mean by that is you're going to have to train and hairspray the top of the wig, which isn't really that hard to do. So if you'll notice, I kind of split it a little bit so that the wefting would be visible through this area. And once I'm done with the wig, what I'll be doing is hairspraying right where I indicated to hold everything in place. And now you can see how it looks compared to the other one. And from here, you could go ahead and move to the next section that you need to change the colors on. And once your wig is done, I would absolutely love to see what you were able to do. But I wish you guys the best of luck, and hopefully everything goes well for you.